In this video, we will continue with our previous desktop automation. So far, we have learned passing data using variables and using them in our recording sequence. There are different methods of receiving data, from simple applications like an Excel file or a web browser, up to the complex legacy and virtual applications like Citrix. Today, we'll be using the simplest method through user input using keyboard entries. We'll discuss getting data from different apps and how to integrate them in a separate video. In UiPath, we use input data to store in a variable which can be used to pass data from one activity to another. In the previous tutorial, we learned how to automate simple calculation through mouse clicks on the calculator app. This time, we'll ask the user to put numbers manually. Let's start by creating three variables. We will use these variables to store the user's input. Let's name it number 1, number 2, and operator. All we have variable type string. Now, the variable operator gives us this warning message. So, we cannot use it because it's a special keyword used by UiPath. Let's replace it with selected operator. Now, let's give them default values so that we can test each variable later. Let's say 1, 2, 3 for number 1, 4, 5, 6 for number 2, and plus for the operator. We are putting it inside a quotation since we're using a variable type string. Starting from now, if you haven't noticed, I always create default values for newly created variables. This is the simplest way for us to see the result after executing the workflow. This will check if it's working properly before we use data from another variable or from another activity. This is very helpful, especially if you are starting to learn UiPath. Let's get to the calculator app workflow. We'll try to replace these three click activities so we can use our three new created variables. First, let's delete the number 3 activity. Let's find type in 2 and put it here. Now, most of the time we need to indicate the text area where we need to type, but that's not the case with our calculator. The app allows you to type a number on your keyboard and it will take it, so let's leave it blank. The input will be the number 1, which will have a value of 1, 2, 3. Let me add a delay after every character has been entered in the options section. Let's say 500. This is in milliseconds, so that's half of a second. Let's copy this activity for our number 2. Remember, when you copy an activity, all of its properties will be copied as well. So, there will be a delay as well. Then, we can just rename the input as number 2, and let's delete the number 5 activity. Our workflow is currently running sequentially in one direction, since we're only using one operator. To provide additional option, we can expand our workflow by setting up a condition. Let's use if activity and drag it after the number 1. In the previous tutorial, we mentioned about flow decision. They have a similar purpose, but we're inside a do sequence. The flow decision will not work because it's only applicable in the main workflow. So it's best to use if in this situation. Now, we can declare a condition. Let's put the variable selected operator equals plus inside a quotation. Then we can drag the add button activity here. That means if the value of the variable selected operator is equal to plus, then it will click the add button. Otherwise, it will perform a different activity. Let's copy this and put it in our else box. And let's change this to a minus sign by clicking the options menu and selecting indicate on screen. This will take a screenshot of the image we want to click on the screen. Before doing this, make sure that you already open the calculator app. Let's click the minus sign. Let's put an appropriate name for it. Let's run it to see how it works. Nice! So, our variables are working correctly. Let's set up another type of input. This time, we'll automate the calculations based on user inputs through an input dialog box. Let's set an input dialog box and name it input number 1. Let's put the title and label for the input box. Next, we will store the user inputs into the variable we previously created. Now, notice if I try to enter a variable number 1, it gives this error message, saying that the variable wasn't declared. If you go to the variables panel, it's not here. There's only one explanation to that. The variable is not globally declared. Let's go to the recording sequence. As you can see, the scope of this variable is limited only inside the sequence container. For us to be able to use it outside the sequence, we need to change the scope to main. Let's do the same with the other two variables. Now, let's go back to our input dialog. The variables are now visible, so we use it with the input activity. Let's copy this input box for our second number and rename it to input box number 2. Let's modify the label. And the variable will be number 2. I'll copy this one more time for our operator activity. I will rename it. And also change the title and label. Since we use two different operations, plus and minus, we'll give our user list of options. So how do we do that? We've been using a variable type string since the first video. Let me introduce you today to an array. If you are a programmer, this is very common. But if you're not, think of an array like a row of bookshelves where you can pick any book you like from. To provide this option to the user, we set an array with two values as an input for our operator. Let's click Options under Input. We can directly set the array here by typing this. We enclose our array in braces. This will mark the beginning and end of the array. Then we enclose each value in quotations. Since we are using a string type array, we separate each value using a comma. Instead of putting the values here directly, let me create a variable and store this array. So let's copy it. Let's go to the variable section and let's add a variable called operator list. For the type, we select array of T, then select string. Then we paste the array here. Then we click the operator activity and put the variable in the options. There, we already have an input for our operators. Next, the output will be operator selected by the user. So we put the variable operator here. Let me make this as a start node so I can show you how it looks like after running it. There, you have the plus and the minus option. Next, let's organize these three input dialogues into one container. Let's create a sequence. Then, we can put three boxes inside. Here's a trick to do it all at once. Press and hold Ctrl key and click these three boxes. Then press Ctrl X to cut. Let's open the sequence and press Ctrl V to paste them. Now, let's arrange the sequence. Let's go back to the main workflow so we can arrange it and give a proper name to our sequence. Let's name it User Input. And Calculator for this one. Good, everything's clear. There's one last thing I wanted to do. Let's open a variables panel. Some of these variables are not in use, which are automatically generated by UiPath. Since we have created and used our own variables, we can clear the end reference variable by going to the Design menu, Manage Variables, and select Remove Unreferenced. So there, it removes the ones that are not in use. Okay, we are ready. Let's run our workflow. Let's put the first number. Let's select plus. And let's put in the second number. Perfect. It performs the plus operation. It also displays the result in the message box and closes the application. Let's run it again. This time, let's use minus. Awesome! Today you have learned how to design an automation that will automatically select an operation based on the user inputs. Isn't it great? In the next video, let's learn how to use an existing workflow with another one. Stay tuned!